Hare Krishna. Jai Radha Madhava Kunja Vihari. Jai Radha Madhava Kunja Vihari. Jai Gopi Janavallabha Girivar Dhanavi Jai Gopi Jai Gopi Janavallabha Girivar Dhanavi Jai Gopi Yasur Nandana Vidhaja Jana Hanjaya Yasur Nandana Vidhaja Jana Hanjaya Jamuna Thira Hevana Chana Dijamu Yamuna Thira Havana Chahadi Jamu Hey Jai Radha Madhava Kunjavi Chahadi Jamu He dhayar hanman madhava kunjavi hari dhan He dhayar gopi janavallabha Giri haradha hari dhan gopi janavallabha Hiri Varga Hiri Chaya Kupi Janavallabha Hiri Varga Dhaha Hiri Chaya Kupi Janavallabha Vijasod Nandana Raja Janahanja Yasur Nandana Vraja Jana Hanja Jamuna Thira Havana Dahayam Jamuna Thira Havana Dahayam Jaiharhaan Madhava Kunjavi Hari Ladamadha Kunjavi Jaiharhaan Madhava Kunjavi Hari Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hari Hari, Hari Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hari Hari, Krishna, Krishna, Bolo Bolo, Rama Rama. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna. Krishna, Krishna, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Nitai Gaur, Hey, Rama Rama, Nitai Gaur, Hari Bol. Hari Bhoi, Hari Bhoi, Hari Bhoi, Jaya Krishna Balaram, Krishna Balaram, Krishna Balaram, Jaya Krishna Balaram. Krishna Balaram, Jaya Krishna Balaram, Krishna Balaram, Krishna Balaram, Jaya Krishna Balaram, Krishna Balaram, Jaya Kishore Kishori, Kishore Kishori, Kishore Kishori, Jaya Kishore Kishori, Hey, Hey, Hi, Kishore Kishori, Kishore Kishori, Kishore Kishori, Jaya Kishore Kishori, Prabhupada, 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 Jai Prabhupada, Nitai Gaur, Hari Bhav, Hari Bhav, Hari Bhav, Hari Bhav, Hari Bhav,
Shri Jagannath Baladev Subhadra Maharani ki jai, Shri Shri Gornithai ki jai, Shri Shri Kishore Kishori ki jai, Srila Prabhupada ki jai, Gaur Premanande Hari 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 Bo. Hare Krishna. And today is the very auspicious and most holy day, one of the most important days of the year for the Vaishnavas, the appearance of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Sri Baladev himself, who is non-different than Krishna. Vrajendra Nandanaye Sachi Suta Hoilo Se Balaram Hoilo Nitai. That same Krishna of Vrindavan Dham has re-manifested himself in a most magnanimous incarnation as Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And Sri Baladram, who is his eternal brother and associate, and Sri Vrindavan Dham, and performs very intimate pastimes with the Lord, has again manifested himself to associate and to assist his brother as Nityananda Prabhu. So there's no difference between Lord Nityananda and Lord Balaram. Anyone who finds a difference, the scriptures give a very strong statement. You say you're an atheist. You see a difference between Balaram and Nityananda. There's no difference. Just the same person in two different forms. So today we're honoring and celebrating Sri Baladev. So we'll read the verse from the 8th canto, chapter 5, the demigods appeal to the Lord for protection, verse 46. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Tastas Vedan Bhutai Rupai. Kale Kale Swayam Vibho. Karma Duvishaham Yano. Bhagavamstat Karotihi. Tastai Swecha Bhutai Rupai. Kale Kale Swayam Vibho. Karma Duvisaham Yano. Bhagavanstat Karotihi. Tastai Swecha Bhutai Rupai. Kale Kale Swayam Vibho. Karma Duvisaham Yano. Bhagavanstat Karotihi. Ladies. Tai. By such appearances, Tai. By such incarnations, Swat Itcha Bhutai. By appearing, all appearing by your personal sweet will. Rupai, by factual forms. Kale Kale, in different millenniums. Swayam, personally. Vibho, O Supreme. Karma, activities. Durvi Saham, uncommon, unable to be enacted by anyone else. Yat, that which. Na, unto us. Bhagavan, the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Tat, that. Karoti, executes. He, indeed. Translation. O Lord, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, by your sweet will, you appear in various incarnations, millennium after millennium, and act wonderfully, performing uncommon activities that would be impossible for us. So the demigods are glorifying the Supreme Lord. Srila Prabhupada's purport. The Lord says in the Bhagavad Gita 4:7, Yada yada hi dharmasya glanir bhavati bharata abhutanam adharmasya tadatmanam srijamiyaham. Whenever and wherever there's a decline in religious practice, O descendant of Bart, and a predominant rise of irreligion, at that time I descend myself. Thus, it is not by imagination, but a fact that the Supreme Personality of Godhead, by his sweet will, appears in different incarnations, such as Matsya, Korma, Varaha, Nisrimha, Vamana, Parasaram, Ramachandra, Balaram, Buddha, and many other forms. Devotees are always eager to see one of the Lord's innumerable forms. It is said that just as no one can count how many waves there are in the sea, no one can count the forms of the Lord. This does not mean, however, that anyone can claim to be a form of the Lord and be acceptable as an incarnation. The incarnation of the Personality of Godhead must be accepted in terms of the descriptions found in the Shastras. I'll read that again. The incarnations of the Supreme Personality of Godhead must be accepted in terms of descriptions found in the Shastras. Lord Brahma is eager to see the incarnations of the Lord, or the original source of all incarnations. He is not eager to see an imposter. The incarnation's activities are proof of his identity. All incarnations described in the Shastras act wonderfully. Keshavadrita Meena Sharihiran Jai Jagadishahare. It is only by the sweet will of the Supreme Personality of Godhead that he appears and disappears, and only fortunate devotees can expect to see him face to face. Om Agyan Timirandasya Kina Jina Salakaya Chaksu Unmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobhistam Staptitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadam Mayam Dadati Swapadantikam Bandeham Shiguro Shiutam Padekamalam Shigurun Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunatam Vitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Sarvadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Sri Radha Krishna Padam Sahagana Lalita Sri Vishakam Vitamscha. Hey Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dinabandhu Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radhakanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneswari Rishabhanu Suti Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vancha Kalpa Taruvischa Kripa Sindhu Bhavacha Patitanam Pavane Bhyo Vaishnave Bhyo Namaha Shri Krishna, Chaitanya, Prabhu Nityananda, Sri Advaita Gadadhar, Sivasati Gaur Bhaktivrindam, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So this verse is quite appropriate for today's appearance of Sri Baladev. So much so that he's actually mentioned in the purport as one of the manifestations of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. But the important part here is, heads up the purport, and that is why the Lord comes. This is very important to understand, because sometimes people claim that the Lord doesn't come to this material world. Why would he come to this place? But here, the Lord makes his statement himself why he comes. He gives his reasons. Not only does he come, but to satisfy everyone's curiosity and understanding of why he's here, he tells you, I've come to when there's a decline in religion in the world, a significant decline. Then I personally descend in my transcendental form. And what do? I arrange by my presence that religious principles become uplifted, or again, people focus on the goal of life. And at the same time, I destroy those miscreants and personalities who are working against irreligion, or working against religion. The atheists, the non-devotees, the envious, like that. But then he also comes for another reason. And that is to give pleasure to his devotees. Because the devotees sacrifice so much on behalf of the Lord wants to please his devotees. So along with coming to destroy the miscreants and to reestablish true Dharma, he wants to give pleasure by his personal presence. And when the Lord was here 5,100 and few years ago, he performs some of his most amazing activities, which attracts the minds and hearts of everyone. We're still reading about that 5,000 years later and becoming attracted and attached to Krishna. And therefore, that is called his, what we say, manifested mercy. He manifests his mercy in different ways, but in this way, it's very special. He gives himself in a very, what we say, intimate way. And along with that, he brings the entire entourage of the spiritual world with him to assist him in his activities in this world. The Lord can only have fun. He doesn't work. We work. That's the problem. We come to this material world and we have to work in order to maintain our bodies and our attachments based on the body, such as family and others. And therefore, we have to struggle unnecessarily because we have made this world a place of what we say, happiness. So we work hard. But God comes and he just has fun. That's all. Because he has nothing to do. Natasya karanam karanam ca vidyate, natasya srotam vihayasute, parasya shakti virhayasute svabhaviki jnana balakriya cha. If he wants to do something, he just desires it, and just everything happens. Prabhupada uses the example of a big man who has a lot of influence in this world. And if he wants to carry out something, he calls his secretaries, he calls his assistants, and they do everything. He simply gives the order. But Krishna doesn't even have to do that. He simply manifests his desire. In other words, he simply desires something and it can. But in order to really to experience his internal loving pleasure, which is the manifestation of the spiritual world, he comes here in his transcendental forms. Although he may do other things such as kill demons and sometimes arrange for political people to become empowered in a political way. Like when Krishna and Balaram were here, they established Ugrasena on the throne after destroying Kamsa. So that was a feature of Krishna's desire to put King Ugrasena, a saintly king, on the throne. So he got involved with some politics, you might say in an indirect way. But what does he do? He just comes here to enjoy himself. God is only enjoying. There's no other activity for God. When he kills, he enjoys. When he performs politics, he enjoys. Whatever he does, it's done in a mood of happiness and enjoyment. And therefore, when he comes to this world, he invites us to take part in that and also become, what we say, free from the hard struggle of material existence. So in enjoying, he invites everyone to enjoy with him like that. So Krishna came 5,000 years ago, and he manifested himself in an expansion of himself, which is non-different than himself. See, this is an important point to understand. God is one. There's no such thing as two gods, two supreme gods. There are smaller gods, such as demigods, or even people in this world may have some position, and they're also considered as lords, or people who are respected in a, what we say, a saintly way, or in a very royal way. But God is one. He is only one. And therefore, he manifests himself in different forms of himself in order to carry out his activities. So when he came as Krishna, he also brought his eternal brother with him, Balaram. Balaram and Krishna, there's no difference. What is the difference? In color only. It says the color of Krishna is compared to a beautiful blackish rain cloud. It's very hard to imagine this particular color because it's not seen anywhere in this world. Therefore, in order to get a little understanding of the beauty of Krishna, which is impossible to fully understand, we use an analogy of something that's beautiful in this world. So the sky, right? They say the sky is beautiful, right? Why? Because it's blue. Such a beautiful blue color, right? And it covers a lot of space too. So Krishna decorates the environment with a beautiful color, which is blue. But then again, if a rain cloud comes in front of that, and it's very dark, that is a, when we say, a blackish color over the bluish color. So behind the blackish color is a tinge of blue. So using that analogy, we get a little bit of an idea what is Krishna's, what we say, original transcendental color, blackish blue like a rain cloud, like that, which is a very beautiful color when combined together. But you can't, although we use a material analogy to describe Krishna and his colors, and we use, just like we say, his feet are like lotuses. So the most beautiful and fragrant of all flowers found in this world is a lotus. And it's so pretty and so nicely, symmetrically, when we say, artistically designed. So something is very beautiful and something is also very rare. The lotus is both beautiful and rare. And using that analogy, Krishna's feet is like a lotus. But these analogies always fall short of the reality. They cannot really describe what is the actual glory and beauty and what we say characteristics of the Supreme Lord. Similarly, Balaram is considered to be whitish. Sometimes like a mountain of snow covered with ice. They say, have you ever seen a mountain covered with snow and ice? It's very beautiful. It's actually considered to be one of the beauties of this world. So Balaram's color is like that. Or compared to that. We might say compared to that. A beautiful, when we say mountain with ice and snow, pure white. But another thing they use is a whitish, a white summer cloud or a white spring cloud, See these big billows of clouds up in the sky, and they're just you look like you could just lay on them and fall asleep or something. They look so soft and so ethereal. It's like something if it was on sale, you would buy it, right? So beautiful, right? I mean, the beauty that into this world is a reflection of the reality of the beauty. But still, there is beauty in the reflection also, because the reflection is simply what it is, the reflection of the reality. So there is beauty in this world, but it's a reflected beauty. So in that reflection, we get an idea of the original. So Balaram is like an icy, snowy mountain, or a beautiful cloud in the sky that is so billowing and so pure white, and it's as white as you can possibly get. It makes white look dark. It's so white. So that's so using those analogies, we can just get a little idea of the nature of the Supreme Personality. So when he manifests himself in this world, he has a particular mission. And of course, it was a time when the world was overburdened with demoniac forces. And that's described nicely in the Mahabharata, the prelude for the appearance of the Lord. And then of course, the demigods petitioning the Lord to come and perform his activities. So when Krishna comes and he brings his manifestation of himself, such as Sri Baladev, everything becomes auspicious like that. So we honor the Supreme Personality of Godhead as one who is very merciful. If you think of a person who has many outstanding qualities, like in this world, what are some of the outstanding qualities of a person? Might be very beautiful or handsome by physical appearance. Or a person may be very intelligent and have great abilities to speak and to understand things and to give amazing, discussions on intricate things. A person who is learned, intelligent, wise. Or a person who is, rich, right? This is what everyone's chasing nowadays, the rich, right? Oh, they got a lot of money. Oh, we want some of it also. Yeah, to be rich means to be famous, means to be in control of a lot of things in this world, you know. So yeah, so that's also a great opulence, wealth. And someone who's strong, you know, can really very powerful. People like to hear about them and see their activities. So these are all opulences. But if any of these persons are not kind, who cares about their opulences? They're just they don't really have any attraction. Although these opulences by nature are attractive, and the reflections of the nature of God. In this world, when people have these, if they're not kind by nature, and they're not charitable and friendly and kind to everyone, care about other, those opulences are just like one big heavy burden. And when one loses their attraction for such individuals. But Krishna has all these amazing opulences, but one thing, he's kind. He's kind. Therefore, he's attractive. And along with all his opulences. And he shows his kindness in so many different ways. So when he appears in one of his forms, or many forms, just to attract the hearts and minds of his devotees. So Balaram is a second manifestation of Lord Sri Krishna, and he has a particular nature. He's God, but he likes to serve God. He wants to be the servant of the Supreme, although he's the Supreme. This is an interesting principle. He manifests himself when the Lord appears in his different, as Ramachandra, he appeared as Lakshman. As Lord Chaitanya, he came as Lord Nityananda. And of course, in his original form, As Balaram, he appeared when Lord Krishna appeared, just to assist the Lord in his pastimes and also to perform his own pastimes. But we might say primarily to give pleasure to the Lord. So we understand there are different rasas. There's different rasas. There's the rasas of, okay, who knows the rasas? What's the first and what we say the most basic of all rasas? What is it called? Okay, well, let's go below that. There's one before that. Shantaras, okay, and that is called neutrality. That's appreciation without activity. Or something that manifests itself in some form, but doesn't perform active service. And then next is what? Dasya, which is, and then Sakya is what? Friendship, to become friends with the Lord. And Vatsalya, what is that one? And for the ladies, what's the last one? Madhurya, Madhu. So Madhurya means what? Conjugal love, but it also has the word Madhu, which means sweet, which is the sweetest of all the rasas. It's a condensation of all the elements of all the other rasas plus an extra element of itself in that, and it's the highest form of spiritual sweetness, Madhurya Ras. So in these five rasas, Lord Balaram is so eager to serve Krishna that he manifests himself in different ways in each of these rasas just to assist the Lord. In the neutral ras, you can look on the altar and you can see Balaram and his neutral ras. What do you see? The Sringasan. The Sringasan is an expansion of Balaram. What else? Shoes. The shoes are an expansion of Balaram. His crown, expansion of Balaram. Practically all the paraphernalia, and sometimes the jewelry and sometimes not. The jewelry are not always a manifestation of Balaram. He doesn't accept any old jewelry. So yeah, and of course, the RT paraphernalia, it's Balaram. So what do we use for kirtan? What? Ladies? Murdanga. Sometimes we say Balaram Murdanga. So Balaram manifests himself as the paraphernalia of the Lord to assist the Lord. That's why we should always take care of the Murdanga, not to put it on the ground and just push it over the side like it's a piece of furniture. Actually, it's very nice to make Murdanga racks. And they're not hard. Temples are doing that around the world. It's a beautiful rack where you can actually place the Murdanga in the rack. And it's off the floor like that. That way we honor Balaram in that form. So the Murdanga, Bartals, especially Murdanga, and a different paraphernalia for worship. The flowers also, like that. So these are the world he wants to serve in that way. As Dasya Ras, he serves by just doing different things to assist the Lord in his pastimes, general service. And Sakya Ras, he becomes the friend of the Lord and assists the Lord as a cowherd boy. Balaram is in that mood of a cowherd boy. Just like he has his gopals. Krishna is also called Gopal. Gopal means one who protects the cow. And so the gopals are also known as cowherd boys. So Balaram is the chief of all the gopals, aside from Krishna, who assists Krishna in his pastimes as a gopal, protecting cows and playing with Krishna in different ways, simply to give Krishna pleasure. The whole principle of the spiritual world is to give pleasure to God. The whole principle of this world is to give pleasure to myself. So it's completely opposite. That's why we say this world is simply a place of suffering, because everyone is trying to make give themselves pleasure and forgetting where pleasure actually lies. The one who gives pleasure to God actually gives pleasure to themselves. But nobody really understands that, or even if they do, they won't accept it, because they think, mistakenly think, the material conception of life is that I am the center. And if I can bring other people into my center and make them happy the way I am happy, I'm a nice guy. I'm pretty good. I'm sharing my position as being the enjoyer with you. Isn't that wonderful? But we're forgetting about the real enjoyer, which is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So therefore, Balaram teaches, because he manifests himself as what? He is also the eternal, original, spiritual master. It says that in the Chaitanya Charitamrita, in the first chapter of CC Adi 1, in verse number 46, it says that the eternal spiritual master, or the pure devotee spiritual master, is a manifestation of Nityananda Balaram, or coming from the Tattva or Srimati Radharani. But we connect him very much with, we connect Balaram very much with the eternal spiritual master. So all the spiritual masters get their power to do their service to the Lord from Baladev, who is the original spiritual master like that. He manifests himself in that way. So one who takes shelter of Balaram actually is getting the mercy of all the spiritual masters. And Balaram gives spiritual strength. He gives spiritual strength. Therefore, his name is Rama. Rama means one who has great strength and takes pleasure in giving, using his strength to purify others like that. So this is Balaramji. He likes to exhibit his strength, not only physical strength, which he does, and in executing his mission of killing demons, but spiritual strength is available through Balaram. So Srila Prabhupada used to say, if you want spiritual strength, pray to Balaram. So this is a good opportunity on today. Today being his appearance day, he's very inclined to give his mercy on these days more so. So pray to the Lord for spiritual strength, because in this world, it's very difficult to practice devotional service, especially in this age of Kali. And therefore, to have spiritual strength is what we say, necessary. So Balaram is the reservoir of that spiritual strength, and he manifests that strength through his eternal spiritual masters like that, or our spiritual master also. But we can pray to Lord Balaram for strength like that. As in the Vatsalya Ras, he manifests himself as the older brother of Krishna. So in Vedic culture, it says that the older brother is almost like a parent to the younger brother or younger sister like that. That is Vedic culture. That the elder brothers in the family take care of the other ones as the parents take care of the children in the same way, like that. That's the mood, it's exactly Vedic culture. So in that mood, Lord Balaram looks out for Krishna. Just like one time, Krishna ate dirt. And Balaram came and told Mother Yasoda, hey, no, he ate dirt. Oh my God, Krishna ate dirt. She became alarmed, thinking, oh, what's gonna happen to him? He's gonna get sick. So she ran over there. He was just a baby at the time, only a few years old. She looked in the mouth, forced his mouth open to look and to see where the dirt was. But Krishna had another plan. And he manifested the universal form within the mouth of himself. And she didn't find dirt, she found mountains, actually. Seas and oceans and cosmic creation. She found everything in the mouth of Krishna. As he was thinking, what is this? What am I seeing? Is this an illusion? Am I dreaming? Or, and then she started to realize, because as she continued to look, she saw herself looking into the mouth of Krishna, within the mouth of Krishna. In other words, she saw everything in creation within the mouth of her little son. And then what happened was, she decided, uh-oh, I think this is God. And Krishna thought, uh-oh, my mother's losing her natural maternal affection for me. This is not good. So he turned off the God potency and went back to a little baby and shut the whole program down. He pulled out the plug. So in that way, she was back to her loving maternal. And that's what Krishna enjoys the most, the natural loving relationship between his devotees. And not the awe and reverence. Awe and reverence is there and is necessary. But on the higher platform, Krishna enjoys the intimacy of love. And awe and reverence is a stage. We practice Krishna consciousness. But through the higher stages of bhakti, one starts to manifest a certain particular relationship with the Lord. But that cannot be surreptitiously or arbitrarily adopted. It comes naturally through the process of bhakti. It doesn't come simply because you want it to happen. It comes automatically. Just like when you eat food and you're having an experience of happiness, satisfaction of hunger, and gradually you're getting to the point of, you know, what we say, fullness. So in the same way, no one has to tell you what the food tastes like, because you're experiencing it. No one has to tell you how much you're experiencing it, whether you like it or not, because you're experiencing it. And no one has to tell you when to stop, because you know how much you should take. So in the same way, on the higher platforms of bhakti, you experience these things, and you just don't artificially adopt these things. But these are the higher mellows. So Krishna didn't want his mother. So the second time Krishna did something is that there was a powerful fire that had engulfed the area of Vraj. And all the cowherd boys and the calves and the cows got really afraid, and they called out to Krishna for help. And Krishna, realizing that he was the only one that could save him, he told everyone, close your eyes. And then he sucked in the whole fire. And everything, when they opened their eyes, everything was nice and everyone felt happy. The fire was gone. Why did he tell everyone to close his eyes? Many times he used to kill a demon and everybody would watch. It's connected with him eating dirt. Because he saw Balaram was there, now Balaram's going to tell my mother I'm eating fire. And now she's really going to be upset and concerned. So in order not to let Balaram see, he has everybody to close their eyes. So these are the pastimes of the Lord, which are full of what we say, these sweet little innuendos of loving relationship between the devotees and the Lord. So Balaram wants to assist Krishna in all these different relationships. That's his mood. He wants to do that more than he wants to perform his own pastimes. Therefore, as the eternal spiritual master, he manifests himself to teach the living entities in this world what is the process of pure devotional service. He empowers his representatives with his own, what we say, shakti, or what we say, intelligence, so they can do the work of bringing the conditioned souls back. So therefore, the spiritual master is a manifestation of Lord Balaram like that. When Balaram was here, there were many, and Krishna was here, there were many demons in Vrindavan. And one demon was Dhenukasura. Now Balaram only killed four demons that we can think of, maybe more, but two were prominent. Dhenukasura, Palambasura, Davida Gorilla, who was not really a demon, but he had taken the form of a gorilla and was harassing everyone. And Balvala, another monkey, I think. That's the four we can remember, but the two that are outstanding is Dainagasura. So Kamsa had this beautiful fruit orchard, which was in the place called Talavan. And it was the best fruit trees in the whole area of Braj. And Dainagasura was commissioned by Kamsa to guard that orchard. No one could get the fruits from that orchard. And Dainuk and his associates, who were in the form of asses, were also enjoying the fruits, but they would guard it. But one day, the cowherd boy said to Krishna, "Hey Krishna, you know there's some really nice fruits in this one forest called Talavan, and you know, we really want them." Because cowherd boys like to eat fruits, right? You guys like to eat fruits? Yeah, fruit is so nice. You can eat it, it's sweet, and at the same time, you don't feel full. When you eat sometimes you eat a big meal, you think, "Oh, I want to go to sleep." But when you eat some fruits, it makes you happy. It's sweet, it's very nourishing. And you make fruit juice out of it. You can also use fruits to decorate things, right? You decorate with grapes and mangoes. And you can use it for decorations. Fruits are very nice, all auspicious. So the cowherd boys love to eat fruit. And so they said to Krishna and Balaram, "There's this nice orchard, really nice fruits. Let's go get them. But there's one problem, there's a demon. He's in the form of an ass. And he's just guarding these fruits and we can't get them." And Krishna wanted to satisfy his friends, so him and Balaram went. So Balaram walks into the forest, and he starts to shake the tree, some of the fruits fall, and he starts enjoying the fruits. And pretty soon this demon, whose name is Dainuk, Asura, he comes and he sees Balaram. "Hey, what is he doing? This is my orchard. He can't do that." And so he ran and he kicked Balaram as hard as he could in the chest. And Balaram just felt it like a little breeze, and then he just kept eating the fruit. No effect, right? So he took another run, decided to try it again. This time Balaram was thinking, "He's disturbing my prasadam here." You know, sometimes when you're sitting eating prasadam, you don't like people harassing you. Talking nonsense. So he came again. This time Balaram just grabbed him by his legs and went, "Whew, whew, whew." And he threw him up into the tall trees. He were really tall trees. And he went flying up there. But by the time he hit the tree, he was already dead. Because the centrifugal force of being spun around by Balaram finished him off. He got dizzy. He died of excessive dizziness. And so... And then all of Dainuk's associates, who were in different asses, they said, "Oh, our leader's been killed. Who's this guy?" So they all came charging. And then Krishna and Balaram had fun. One after another, they start grabbing these asses and just flinging them and throwing them up in the trees. Because they had two purposes: to kill the demon, then knock the fruits down so the fruits could fall on the ground. And that way they wouldn't have to worry about, you know, doing extra work to get the fruit. And then all the cowherd boys were enjoying the fruit. And so it's described that there was like, each of these asses had a particular color. So they were, it was like a really like rainbow ass program. Different color asses and different, you know, purple and turquoise, pink, blue, yellow, green, red. You know, it was an assarama, to use it. Of course, Ram is also there. So they had a good time, and all these demons were killed. Now, Dainagasura, he represents, because what is an ass? An ass works hard for what? What? What does he get for working? Grass. Or maybe he gets a little flower or something. He's willing to do hard work just to get something to eat. And therefore, it's compared to these different asses are actually teaching us different, what we say, anarthas in this material world. People work hard just for food, or just to maintain their bodies, which are not, cannot be maintained anyway. So therefore, people who have that mentality are no better than Deinuk. To work hard simply to get some grass or something. When, if you serve the Supreme Personality of Godhead, you don't need to work. God provides everything for you. Everything is provided by the Lord for one who takes shelter of the Lord and engages in the Lord's service, which is natural. But people think, why should I serve? I'm going to work. I'm going to make money. I'm going to enjoy. But who's enjoying? And who's making money? The government's making money, that's all. Nobody else makes money. They print it every day. So this is the ass mentality, simply working hard to maintain one's material body. And another thing is the ass, Deinukasura, represents useless knowledge. And you see people in today's world, they accumulate knowledge. They read so many books, they study, they have libraries. I remember I was doing one program at one college university many, many years ago. I think it was back in the 90s. And I think it was somewhere in this area here. And the professor invited me in his office. And my God, he had these bookshelves that went all the way up to the ceiling. You couldn't even reach the books. You need a stepladder to get to the books. And it was like row after row of books, way up high, covering practically three quarters of the room, of all these books. And I asked him, did you read all that? He said, no. But they have this idea accumulating, the more I know, the more, you know, I'm appreciated, I'm seen as great, I feel good about myself. I am intelligent. It's a symptom of a false. But what is that knowledge? It's useless. What does it get you? It gets you another birth in this material world. It's useless knowledge. We might even say it's not even knowledge. It is called nescience. That information that takes you away from real knowledge. Stops you from learning the real knowledge like that. So this is Deinukasura, carrying the big burden of useless knowledge. And therefore, by the mercy of Lord Balaram, coming through the spiritual master, one can destroy this demon called Deinukasura, working hard simply to maintain one's body, working hard simply to accumulate what we say material knowledge like that. So that is the mercy of Balaram. So Balaram comes just to give his mercy in different manifestations of himself. So tonight we'll speak a little bit more. I think His Holiness Radhanath Maharaj will be coming to also enlighten everyone on the intricacies of the activities of Lord Balaram and his wonderful qualities. So I'll stop there. Any questions? Comments? Yes, Subal Prabhu.
Thank you so much, Maharaj.
You like the ass story, huh?
Hare Krishna. I have a question in terms of, so as Vaishnavas, or even a tradition, we have the Supreme Personality of Godhead as the perfect, as a devotee, in the mood of a devotee, and we have the perfect devotee in Srimati Radharani. So how exactly, when you take shelter to become a devotee, what's the difference, or how you have these two
personalities? One is Shakti Mam. Radharani, although she is non-different than Krishna, she's considered to be his Ladini Shakti, his pleasure energy. Balaram is, you know, she's Shakti Tattva, where she manifests herself to serve the Lord in different forms of herself as she expands in the forms of the gopis, the Lakshmis, and the queens of Dwarka. So she is the female manifestation of the absolute truth to give pleasure to the Supreme Lord. Balaram also has that manifestation within his category. He has his Shakti energies too, which are actually expansions of Radharani, Revati and Kalindi. They are also manifestation of Srimati Radharani. But Balaram is considered to be none different than Krishna. And so he is considered to be the source. But at the same time, although he is the source, he manifests himself as a servant. As a source, he expands himself into the Vasudev forms, Vasudev, Sankarshan, Aniruddha, and Pradyumna. And from the, then they expand into the Narayan. This is mentioned in Bhagavatam. And Narayan expands into the second Chaturvyuha, Vasudev, Sankarshana, Pradyumna, and Aniruddha. And then that second Sankarshana manifests himself as Mahavishnu. So Mahavishnu begins the creation of the material world, and from Mahavishnu, so many manifestations of the creation, the forms of the Lord for creation, and for what we say, facilitating the creation, such as Shirodashlai Vishnu, the super soul. These are all expansions of Balaram. These are all expansions of Balaram. For Radharani's expansions are the female Shaktis for the pleasure, the internal pleasure of the Supreme Lord, like that. So both do the same work, but the categories, the tattvas are different, like that. You see the difference? One is for the female expansions and one is for the expansions of facilitating Krishna's pastimes in the form of creation and the form of his internal energy. As a cowherd boy like that in Vrindavan. Radharani is not the friend of Krishna. She's the paramour like that. Yeah. But it's interesting because I didn't mention it, but Balaram expands himself in Madhurya Rasa also as Ananga Manjari, who is the younger sister of Radharani. So Balaram performs that work in all five rasas. So as Ananga Manjari, and he is also in the female Shaktis, in the pleasure potency energy like that. So both play the role of giving Krishna pleasure like that from different angles, that's all.
Krishna? Maharaj, since you're talking about the expansions, and you told that Krishna and Balaram, they are Swayam Bhagwan. Balaram is the next immediate expansion of Krishna, and the two are original Purusha. So what I understand is that, correct me if I'm wrong, from Balarama, Anantashesh expanded, and that Anantashesh serves as a paraphernalia, shoes, right. Cushion. Okay, so not Balaram doesn't play a role, but
for the manifestation of creation, Balaram expands in five. He's Mahavishnu, he's Karanadaksha, he's Garbhadaksha Vishnu, he's Shirodaksha Vishnu, and he's called Mula Sankarshana. But in the fifth, he's Shesh. And Shesh, he is the pastime manifestation of the Lord, only in Shesh. So the other form is for creation.
Okay, that makes
so in
sense.
The pastime form of the Lord, yeah, he performs those activities. Yeah.
My next immediate question: you were explaining that quadruple expansions, Balarama, Aniruddha, Pradyumna, Vasudev, Pradyum, Aniruddha. There are four expansion first, and then second quadruple expansion. Again, there is same thing, and the second Sankarshan act as a Mahavishnu.
Expands into Mahavishnu.
Mahavishnu, that is a Karanadakshai Vishnu.
Right.
And from there is a Garbhadakshai Vishnu.
Yeah.
And I heard that Shirodakshai Vishnu, he is in the milk ocean. So how come he's in the, because he is the Paramatma in everyone's heart. Mm-hmm. So I'm not getting the picture.
Sometimes Garbhodaksha Vishnu is also considered Paramatma. I was just reading that yesterday in the fifth chapter of Adi Lila, just explaining that. It's very difficult to understand because the Shastras give different terminologies that apply to both. But the thing is, they're not wrong, because although there's different functions, sometimes the functions are the same in different manifestations. So as Shiradakshay Vishnu, he is the aggregate of the Super Soul. He's the combined energy of the Super Soul. And as he manifests in this world, he takes the form of in expanding into the hearts of all living entities. Mm-hmm. So what is the question?
My question is, first of all, I want to add something that in Bhagavatam, in both the commentary, in Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur and Prabhupada's commentary, in both the commentaries, Shiradakshay Vishnu is considered as a Paramatma, and all the incarnations are coming from Shiradakshay Vishnu.
Coming through.
Through Shiradakshay Vishnu.
Not in, coming, not coming from coming through. It's a gateway.
Yeah, so.
That's explained. Even Chaitanya Mahaprabhu comes through Shiradakshay Vishnu. That's mentioned. Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. Wow. It's like the doorway. You want to go into the temple, you need to get a doorway. So
that is quite contradictory then. Garbhodaksha Vishnu is also Paramatma, and all the incarnations, CC also mentioned that all the incarnations are coming from Garbhodaksha Vishnu, through Garbhodaksha Vishnu, and Bhagavatam is saying all incarnations are coming through Shiradakshay Vishnu.
There's no difference between Shiradakshya Vishnu and Garbhodaksha Vishnu.
Anyways, so my question...
That's the point that the Chaitanya Charitamrita makes. These manifestations of the different forms of the Lord play similar functions and also play different functions.
So you mean that Shiradakshay Vishnu can play the role of Garbhodaksha Vishnu?
Garbhodaksha Vishnu is also called Super Soul.
Okay.
I can find it for you. It's in the fifth chapter of Chaitanya Charitamrita.
No, I read that chapter, yes. And that's why I asked this question. My question is that in the same chapter, it has shown that Shiradakshay Vishnu is lying in the milk ocean. How can the Shiradakshay Vishnu can lie in the milk ocean, since he is the aggregate of all non-living and living entities?
Why can't he do that?
Why? How can he live in the milk ocean? Because it's mentioned over there that Shiradakshay Vishnu is living in the milk ocean.
Yeah.
Shweta Deep, he has his own planet called Shweta Deep, mm-hmm. and he's staying over there. So I was confused with that picture, that how to...
Shweta Deep is a spiritual planet in the material world. It's a spiritual planet. It's not a material planet. It's where the Lord resides in the material world. It's non-different than Vaikuntha. Another name for Goloka Vrindavan is Shweta Deep. Another name. Goloka Vrindavan has four names. One of them is Shweta Deep. Like that. So yeah, but that planet is not material. You can't go there. You can go there, you know, if you qualify yourself on the spiritual platform, but it's not a physical planet.
All demigods are praying. They are praying to Shiradakshay Vishnu on the
shore of the ocean. Okay. They don't go on to the planet. They're sending radio messages.
My second question, you're talking about that how our spiritual master is either the manifestation of Srimati Radharani or Lord Nityananda. So
it says the spiritual master can come from either one of these tattvas.
None of the tattvas.
Huh?
One of the tattvas.
Yeah.
So how to understand that our spiritual master is coming from which tattva? Or how should we understand that thing?
You're going to try to find out? I don't think even the spiritual masters know what tattva they come from. You have to understand the principle that governs this understanding, and that is that the empowerment is coming through either one of these two tattvas. So some of the spiritual masters have the rasa of Sakya, and some have the rasa of Madhurya. So depending on their rasa, And then they come through that, and that's where they're coming from. They're empowered by that. Yeah, Prabhupada says that in one purport. The spiritual masters are either in Sakya Ras or Madhurya Ras, which corresponds to, you know, Balaram and Radharani, or Nityananda.
I'm not trying to extend this, but the thing is that...
No, you're good. I like this. This is
the spiritual master, ultimately, he should know, right? What is his...
The thing is, try to accept the answers without running to the next question. You got the answers?
Oh, the tattva, where he's coming from. So, but he should ultimately know, because he is guiding his disciple.
He can know when he realizes his internal position. And that is called siddha pranali, or perfection. One, when he gets to that stage. If he's an eternal associate of the Lord in the spiritual world and he manifests himself then, he knows. If he's a person who comes to the material world and then becomes a spiritual master through empowerment, he may know only at a later stage of his own spiritual practice. But in any case, he can know. Prabhupada always knew, because Prabhupada is a direct manifestation of an internal associate of the Lord. Prabhupada knew who he was in the spiritual world. And he even said that many times. If I told you who I was, you'd faint. He's not a small personality. He came to do this work. Krishna sent him. But there are other spiritual masters who are not sent by Krishna, but become empowered to do the work of a spiritual master simply by the strength of their own spiritual practice. So different kinds of spiritual masters. One comes directly from the Lord, and one becomes empowered by the Lord through qualification. But both are spiritual masters. You can keep going. You got some more?
Maharaj, you told that Krishna and Balaram also means Krishna incarnate as a Krishna and Balaram. There are different incarnation of Krishna. And there are different, like Varaha, Narna and Rishi, Kapila, everything. There are several, like 22 incarnation. And among those 22 incarnation, Krishna and Balaram is mentioned like 19 or 20th. So how can we consider that among all those incarnation, Krishna and Balaram are the main persons to be worshipped, the Supreme Personality of Godhead?
They're known as both. Because they descended into this material world, they're the incarnations. Because they're the saucer of the incarnations, they're also known as the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Because they descended, they're called incarnations, that's all.
That among all these 22 incarnations, Krishna and Balaram are the main personality of God.
It says in the Bhagavatam, Ete cham sam kalom pumsam, Krishna's tu Bhagavan swayam. All the plenary portions and portions of the plenary portions are simply coming from the original source, which is Sri Krishna himself. That's 1.3.28 in Bhagavatam. You can find that verse. So yeah, he's called incarnation because he descends, that's all. But he's the source of the, and just like Lord Chaitanya is also called an incarnation, but we know he is avatari. He's an avatar, but he's the source of other avatars. Sri Krishna Chaitanya, Radha Krishna Nohyonya. He's both Radha and Krishna in one, but he descends as a devotee of the Lord and not as the Lord himself. But still, he's the source. And Krishna, Lord Chaitanya showed that. He manifested his Nrisinga form. He manifested his Varaha form. What else did he manifest? Kapila, Ram, and Ram. Yeah, while he was here, he exhibited these different forms of himself in his Leelas, like that. So Krishna is the source, Ishwara Parma Krishna, Satchit Ananda Vigraha, Anadir Adir Govinde Sarva Karna Karna. That verse establishes Krishna as the source of everything. There's no second person. Krishna is the original. He's Adi, Adi Purush. There are many Purush, but he is Adi Purush. That source of all the other Purushas.
Thank you. Does the neutrality has a place in both Vaikuntha and Golok Vrindavan?
Here we go. Neutrality have a base in both Goloka? This is a controversial discussion. Some people say neutrality doesn't exist in Goloka, and others say it does. It does manifest itself in this world. And some people say it doesn't. So the Acharyas discuss it from different angles of vision. Because they say that even the rocks and the trees and the immovable objects are in the mood of dasya in the spiritual world. Because everything is serving Krishna. Whereas something immovable cannot do any service in the material world, so therefore neutrality is understood in that sense. When the Lord performs his activities in this world. But in the spiritual world, now you'll get different acharyas commenting on this from different angles of vision. One very learned devotee in our movement sent me a whole treatise explanation of how neutrality is there in the spiritual world. And others, I was talking to somebody else just recently, and they said, no, it's not there. It starts with dasya.
I have one question then. How about Govardhan Hill? He's in neutrality or dasya? Because dasya is the base of all the rasa in Vaikuntha and Goloka. But I think Govardhan Hill might be neutrality. I'm asking a question.
Govardhan Hill serves Krishna in different ways. He's called Haridas Varya. Haridas Varya means he's the best of all devotees. Provides caves for Krishna and Balaram to sleep in. He gives them fruits, nice trees for tree shade, gives them fruits. He has lakes and ponds around him where they can bathe and perform activities. Govardhan serves in so many ways. Govardhan?
What does mean everything is dasya, but Govardhan is a neutral or what kind of?
What is Govardhan? What is his actual? Seems like it appears, according to the Shastric evidence of his activities, since he's in dasya ras. It appears to be.
But dasya is a common for all the rasa in Goloka. That's the main base. But
in Goloka, there's nothing inanimate, everything is animate. Everything has consciousness. In this world, a mountain. Mountains used to be conscious, but not no more. They used to fly. Mountains used to be living entities. But Indra cut off their wings, and now the mountains don't fly anymore. But they're still living entities. So check with some higher authorities on this one. Because all I can say is that I've heard from both sides. And therefore, both have convincing arguments that there is neutrality in the spiritual world and there isn't neutrality in the spiritual world. So the only one way, if you want to find out, I mean, take Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur's Jiva Goswami's commentaries and try to study them and see what you can come up with. Yes, Shiv, you got something on that? I mean, we discussed this, and one very senior lady in our movement, who is a Shastric genius, came up and she sent me this whole thing. Spirit of Dasya is, Shanta is in the spiritual world. I have it on my computer. It's a 45-page report. But then I was just recently with somebody, and we were talking about it, and this very senior devotee said, no, because even the inanimate objects are in the mood of service. So You want to find out for sure? Go back to the spiritual world. Personal evidence. So you might say, who's right and who's wrong? It's not a matter of right and wrong. You just have to understand the different angles of vision that give the understandings from both sides. So you might say both are right. Because in spiritual life, two things can be different and both be correct at the same time. You can't find that in this world.
One last question. You told that the Krishna has came because in the beginning of the lecture, you told that Krishna came for two reasons. First is to establish dharma, and the other reason is to give the pleasure to his devotees, because devotee has sacrificed everything. But I was thinking this point, and I was understanding in this way, that if a person is not getting anything, any kind of reciprocation, then why he would sacrifice? Because he is getting something, that's why he's sacrificing. And that means Krishna, in order to make us perfect, he is working hard rather than we are working hard. Because you told that Krishna wants to give pleasure to his devotee, because devotees have sacrificed everything, but it seems that no one will sacrifice anything if he's not getting something from the other party.
So
in one sense, Krishna is working hard, we are not doing anything, we are not sacrificing.
He's not working hard. He doesn't work at all. You work, he doesn't work. He simply enjoys.
Understand this, that because devotees are sacrificing everything, but in one sense, if I'm not getting something from Krishna, why should I sacrifice my other material things?
Who's got the Veda base? Okay. Srimad Bhagavatam, 5th canto, 18th chapter, verse number 9. In the purports. And the end of the purport, this is a prayer by Prahlad Maharaj. It's a beautiful prayer. Yeah. In the end of the purport, what does Prabhupada say? He says, he quotes Bhaktivinoda Thakur.
Sure. If they think of Krishna always, everything will be all right. Some people argue that if everyone thought of Krishna in that way, then the whole universe would be vacated because everyone would go back home, back to Godhead. However, Sri Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur says that this is impossible because the living entities are innumerable. If one set of living entities is actually delivered by the Krishna consciousness movement, another set will fill the entire universe.
Well, but there's a quote by Bhaktivinoda Thakur in the purport there. No? If it's not in that verse, it's in the previous verse, but I think it's in that verse. It's maybe at the beginning of the purport. Okay, then go to the previous verse and see. Prabhupada says, Bhaktivinoda Thakur says, it's in one of those purports. No, it has to be. It has to be in one of those two verses. No. It's either 8 or 9. Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur says, wherever there is a living entity, there is a request for a benediction. Yeah, does anybody have the actual text? Do you have the fifth canto here in book form? This is what's worth waiting for, because it's very, very fundamental. This is a good question. Fifth chapter, the 18th chapter. Nine. There's no quote by Bhaktivinoda? Maybe it's Vishwanath. What does he say? Let's see. Now we want part two here. Okay. You find it? Which verse?
Hold on.
You find it?
Number nine?
Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur has given us a very fine purport in this regard. Whenever one offers a prayer to the Supreme Personality of Godhead, one always requests some benediction from Him.
Yeah.
Even pure Nishkama devotees pray for some benediction as instructed by Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in His Sikshashtaka. Ayananda Tanuja Kinkaram Patitam Mam Vishame Bhavam Budau Kripaya Tava Pada Pankajau Stitadhuli Sadrisham Vichintaya. O son of Maharaj Nanda Krishna, I am your eternal servitor, yet somehow or other I have fallen into the ocean of birth and death. Please pick me up from the ocean of death and place me as one of the atoms at your lotus feet. In another prayer, Lord Chaitanya says, Mama Janmani Janmanishwari Bhavatar Bhaktir Ahaituki Tvai. Life after life, kindly let me have unalloyed love and devotion at your Lordship's lotus feet. When Prahlad Maharaj chants Om Namo Bhagavate Narasimhaya, he prays for a benediction from the Lord. But because he is also an exalted Vaishnava, he wants nothing for his personal sense gratification. The first desire expressed in his prayer is Swasti Astu Vishwasaya. Let there be good fortune throughout the entire universe. Prahlad Maharaj thus requested the Lord to be merciful to everyone, including his father, a most envious person.
Yeah. Okay, that's the point. Wherever there's a prayer, there's a benediction. There's a request. Thank you. I'm sorry, I was thinking Bhaktivinoda, but it's Vishwanath Chakravarti. Yeah, and so wherever there's a prayer, there's a benediction. Even great souls, they're asking the Lord for something. But they don't ask for themselves. They're asking for good fortune for others. Or something completely selfless. So you can't make a prayer to the Lord without asking what's there's some request there. Something. Okay. Thank you. Got any more questions? I like your questions. They're good questions. Very good questions. This is Bodhyantas Parasparam Katyantas Chamam Tudyantus Yanti Chan. Discuss the scriptures. Talk about them from different angles of vision. Go deeper into it, and that way you'll understand the process of bhakti. Okay, thank you very much. Sri Baladev Ki Jai. Sisi Kishore Kishori Ki. Gornitai Ki Jai. And Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Srimad Bhagavatam Ki Jai.